down onto the global capitalist system as such, but on its secondary accidental deviations. Too large legal regulations, the corruption of big financial institutions, and so on. Against this tendency, one should insist on the key question. Which flaw of the system as such opens up the possibility for crises and collapses? The first thing to bear in mind is that the origin of the crisis was a benevolent one. After the digital bubble, in the first years of the new millennium, the decision across the party lines in the United States was to facilitate real estate investments in order to keep economy going. Today's meltdown is the price paid for the fact that the United States avoided a recession 5-6 years ago. The danger is thus that the predominant narrative of the meltdown will be the one which, instead of awakening us from a dream, will enable us to continue to dream. And it is here that we should start to worry, not only about the economic consequences of the meltdown, the so-called, to use the nice euphemism, further structural adjustments, but we should worry about the obvious temptation to reinvigorate the war on terror or interventionism, military interventionism in order to keep the economy running, or in home politics, the sudden rise of populist racism all around Europe. I more and more think that in this post-political era where we are today, that we are slowly approaching a new model in the developed states, where the two parties are no longer moderate left, moderate right, but, what they call it, a neutral technocratic party, usually more culturally open, post-political, claiming we are just for reasonable administration. So, pure technocratic party and more rightist populist party. That's the only alternative, unfortunately, which is emerging. An exemplary case of how the meltdown already is used in ideological political struggle is the debate in the United States on what to do with General Motors. Should the state allow its bankruptcy or not? Since General Motors is one of the institutions which define the so-called American dream, its bankruptcy was long considered unthinkable. But more and more voices now refer to the meltdown as the additional push which should make us accept the unthinkable. For example, a recent column in New York Times with the title Imagining General Motors Bankruptcy dotted the I when it focused on the standoff between General Motors and its unionized workers. Here is a quote. Bankruptcy would allow General Motors to unilaterally reject its collective bargaining agreements as long as a judge approved. End of quote. In other words, bankruptcy should be used to break the backbone of one of the last remaining strong trade unions in the United States, leaving thousands with lower wages and other thousands, much more tragically, with lower retirement sums. Note the contrast with the urgency to save the big banks. Here, where the survival of thousands of active or retired workers is at stake, there is of course no emergency, but on the contrary, an opportunity to allow free market to show its brutal force. And if the trade unions, as if the trade unions, not the wrong strategy of the managers, are to be blamed for the General Motors troubled waters. This is how the impossible becomes possible. What was hitherto considered unthinkable within the horizon of the established standards of work decency and solidarity should become acceptable. Marx wrote that bourgeois ideology loves to historicize. Every social, religious, cultural forum is historical, contingent, relative, every forum with the exception of its own. There was history, as Marx put it, but now there is no history. With capitalist liberalism, history is at an end, the natural forum is found. This old paradox of liberal ideology exploded with new power in today's apologies of the end of history. to get a clinically pure, as it were, distilled version of today's capitalist ideology, one should turn not so much to Fukuyama as to, my choice, Guy Storman, a French journalist ideologist. I will not call him theoretician. The very title of the interview, one of the interviews he recently gave, "This Crisis Will Be Short Enough," signals that Storman fulfills the basic demand that ideology has to meet with regard of the financial meltdown to renormalize the situation. A quote: "This ceaseless replacement of the old with the new driven by technical innovation and entrepreneurialism, itself encouraged by good economic policies, brings prosperity. Though those displaced by the process, who find their jobs made redundant, can understandably object to it." End of quote. This renormalization, of course, coexists with its opposite: the panic raised by the authorities in order to create a shock among the white public. The very fundamentals of our way of life are threatened, and thereby to make the public ready to accept the proposed solutions. Back to Storman. His starting premise is that in the last decades, more precisely after the fall of socialism in 1990, economy finally became a fully tested science. In an almost laboratory situation, the same country was split into two: West and East Germany, South and North Korea, South and North Vietnam. Each part submitted to the opposite economic system, and the result was unambiguous. But I ask myself, is economy really a science? Does the present crisis not demonstrate that, as one of the participants put it, no one really knows what to do? The reason is that expectations are part of the game. How the market will react depends not only on how much people trust the interventions, but even more on how much they think others will trust them. One cannot take into account the effects of one's own interventions. So while Storman admits that market is full of irrational behavior, his medicament is not even psychology, but neuroeconomics. Listen, a quote: "Economic actors tend to behave both rationally and irrationally. Laboratory work has demonstrated that one part of our brain bears blame for many of our economically mistaken short-term decisions, while another is responsible for decisions that make economic sense, usually taking a longer view. Just as the state protects us from Akerlof's asymmetry by forbidding insider trading, should it also protect us from our own irrational impulses?" Question mark. End of quote. Of course, Storman is quick to add that, another quote, "it would be preposterous to use behavioral economics to justify restoring excessive state regulations. After all, the state is no more rational than the individual, and its actions can have enormously destructive consequences. Neuroeconomics should encourage us to make markets more transparent, not more regulated." End of quote. I mean, I found this proposal wonderful, to treat this necessary psychological effect of capitalist market, so-called irrational behavior, as a neuronally based pathology to be treated in this way. With this happy twin rule of economic science supplemented by neuroeconomics, gone are the times of ideological dreams masked as science. So, Storman claims, as it was the case of Marx, whose work, quote, "can be described as a materialist rewriting of the Bible," end of quote. But even if Marxism is dead, the naked emperor continues to haunt us with new clothes, the chief among them, according to Storman, ecologism. Storman claims that the ecological movement is the communism of the 21st century. Quote, "it is certain that ecologism is a recreation of communism, the actual anti-capitalism. However, its other half is composed of a quarter of pagan utopia, of the cult of nature, which is much earlier than Marxism, which is why ecologism is so strong in Germany with its